Okemah, Oklahoma. Woody knows what that lost train means because he's ridden off the Red Ball freight from one end of the country to another. In a few minutes, we're going to begin a conversation with Woody Guthrie about life in the Southwest, about where he's from and where he went and what happened.
When he went to the hospital the first time and my mom went to visit him, a big German doctor, psychologist type, said, "Excuse me, Mrs. Guthrie, but you know, your husband has delusions of grandeur, you know, and he says he's written a book, you know, he says he's a singer." And my mom said, "You know, no, he's really done all these things." The guy, you know, couldn't believe it. He thought he had a real case, and he didn't. And I think, as surprising as it was to the doctor, the world finds it surprising that he could be himself, that he could be the legend he had created.
Woody Guthrie is, I guess, about 30 years old from the looks of him, but he's seen more in those 30 years than most men see before they're 70. Gone out in the world, looked at the faces of hungry men and women. He lived in hobo jungles. He's performed on picket lines. He's sung his way through every bar and saloon between Oklahoma and California. And listen to that red ball roll.
Woody Guthrie was born into a family made rich by the Oklahoma oil boom. But by the time he was 8, his mother was in an insane asylum, and his father had lost every penny he had. His personal life was a catalogue of tragedy and disease, yet he had a vision that inspired two generations of Americans. The dustiest of the dust bowlers, Guthrie made his own life into a myth. He appointed himself spokesman for the poor and oppressed, and through his songs, turned their life into his own.
Woody, how long was it ago that you were born in Okemah?
28 years, you pretty near guessed it. I was born there on July the 14th, 1912. All up and down the whole country there, they got oil. Got some pretty nice oil fields around Okemah there.
Did any of the oil come in your family?
No, no, we got the grease.
Oh, he was just an ordinary kid. You couldn't tell. I never did hear him sing. We left there before he started on the road singing. See, what was that song he made popular? I mean, "This Is My Land Is Your Land" or something like that.
They're lonesome for a job, lonesome for good times, pretty gals, fine women and song. You know, down and out and disgusted and busted and can't be trusted. Why, gives you a lonesome feeling.
We first discovered, Woody and I, that we could do a harmonica duet. We didn't play the fiddle and the banjo very good, but we could play the harmonica a little bit. And I played quite a while with Woody before I discovered he played the harmonica left-handed, if you can believe that. And instead of the bass notes down here on the left, he turned it over. And maybe that helped him make some of these notes. You get a lot of low blues notes when you're playing train pieces.
Sorry.
I learned how to play a French harp off a boy that shined shoes down there. I was passing a barbershop one day, and I was about 15 or 16 years old, and there's a boy, a big barefooted boy, up laying in there, and had his feet turned up towards me and...
One more time.
He was playing the railroad blues. Undoubtedly the lonesomest piece of music that I ever run on to in my life. Where in the world did you learn it? Oh, he said, I just lay here and listen to the railroad whistle. And he said, what if it say I say too?
The 22nd, 1940, and we're continuing Mr. Woody Guthrie's records of Texas, Oklahoma, and California.
Guthrie's account of his own life was recorded by the great folklorist Alan Lomax.
You know, Woody was small, a combative, aggressive little guy with a great wit, and you could never get him in the corner because he could always fight his way out with his tongue. And, if you listen to those his consonants when he sings, when he will sing a D after a long-held vowel and hit it right on like a boxer hits a bag. His enunciation is superb. Who gave him that idea? I don't know. But it so you understand every single syllable that he sings, which is more than you can say for a lot of the people who come after him.
Only two fragments of film survive of Guthrie performing. One of them, lost in the archives for 40 years, has only just come to light.
But the rustlers broke on us in the dead hours of night. She rose from her blanket, a battle to fight. Rose from her blanket with a gun in each hand, said, come all of you cowboys, fight for your land.
I wasn't in the class that John Steinbeck called the Okies, because my dad, to start with, was worth about $35,000 or $40,000, and he had everything hunky-dory. Then he started having a little bad luck. In fact, our whole family had a little bit of it. I don't know whether it's worth talking about or not. I never do talk it much. But then all of my brothers and sisters, I got another sister and two brothers, and they all felt pretty good until all these things happened and they found themselves scattered. All us kids had to scatter out and be adopted by different families.
I am standing in what was the Woody Guthrie in my home place. I don't know, it's kind of hard to describe. The only thing that I learned to accept was Papa's gone, Mama's gone, Woody's gone, Claire's gone, Roy's gone. Why should the house not be gone?
When this six-room house burned down that I told you about, right after that, my 14-year-old sister either set herself afire or caught a fire accidentally. There's two different stories got out about it. Anyway, she She caught a fire while she was doing some ironing that afternoon on the old kerosene stove. Run around the house about twice before anybody could catch her. Next day, she died. And my mother, that was a little bit too much for her nerves or something. I don't know exactly how it was, but anyway, my mother died in the insane asylum at Norman, Oklahoma.
She died of Huntington's chorea, a hereditary nervous disease that was to strike Guthrie himself 20 years later.
I feel like that Mama's actions were Huntington's then was the reason that she forced Clara to stay home from school, because she was not thinking rationally. And she was more or less punishing Clara. And Clara said, if you make me stay home from school today, I'll kill myself. And she did. In the meantime, someone saw my dad downtown. He said, Charlie said, there's a fire. And he said, I think it's at your house. And he just lived close enough. He just started running. And he ran all the way to the house. And when he got there, Clara was standing in the front yard. And her clothes were all burned off of her. And Papa said her skin was just hanging in big sheets, just hanging all over. And he couldn't touch her. She was burned so bad. But he fell down on the ground in front of her and just started, just went to pieces. And she says, Papa, don't cry. I'm not hurt. And she didn't live through the night.
Then about that same time, my father mysteriously, for some reason or other, caught a fire. There's a lot of people say that he set himself afire. Others say that he caught a fire accidentally. I always will think that he'd done it on purpose.
He told me that he was working on a car, and he got gasoline all over him. And when he got out from under the car and stood up, he lit a cigarette, and it exploded. Had that happened, just like Papa said it would have burned him, you know, here, real bad. Here, Papa doesn't have any scars anywhere except right here. So that tells me that she did pour the stuff and ignite it while he was lying down. He was burned lying down. And he never would admit it because he wouldn't say anything against our mother. Never. And I think that's nice.
In 1936, Guthrie joined the Pampa Junior Chamber of Commerce Band. He was its leading light.
If I had never spoke to this little guy in the 10th grade and asked him to draw a picture of a cowboy on this bucking horse, I wouldn't have been out here polishing the windows this morning.
Another member of the band was his future brother-in-law, Matt Jennings.
He was a regular clown. He would play... Sometimes he would take hat pins. We don't even see hat pins anymore. And Jeff or somebody would be playing the violin, and he would beat on the strings with them. So you get a secondary effect up there. Besides the bow that's striking the strings, you get another spook in the background there.
I had very long blonde hair, natural blonde hair. And the remark he put in one of his books was that when he saw me walking down the street, this is before he met me, that he said he was going to marry me. Now, that was kid stuff.
He got married in a little Catholic church there in Pampa, Texas. I don't know whether that was the first time Woody went to church or not.
You know, he told Matt that his mother was in the insane asylum. He never did tell me that. He never did. And of course, they did not know what was wrong with her for many years. Not until Woody was sick.
She rose from her blanket, a battle to fight.
I think the first time that he ever mentioned his mom. We had a very lively night, and before we went to sleep, he started to talk about his mom, first time.
You cowboys, fight for your land.
He says she died last week. I had a letter from Oklahoma, and my mother's dead. And that got my attention pretty good. And he went on to tell how he'd visited this insane asylum before he left Oklahoma. And he was there the longest time, and she couldn't recognize him. But I believe just before he left, she called him over to the bed and says, "You're Woodrow." That was a pretty bad afternoon for the little guy. He was pretty, maybe 9 years old or so. But he told me that Huntington's disease could come from father to daughter or mother to son. That's the only way it could be transmitted, so made him some sort of a candidate, about a 50-50 chance that he would get it. But we were like 19 years old, I guess. There's no way in the world anything could go wrong for us. You never know. It's the way it is.
So long, it's been good to know you. So long, been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. This dusty old dust is a blowing me home. I've got to be rolling along. Some of the worst dust storms in the history of the whole world, I guess, broke loose. That was the big middle of the dust bowl. I'll sing this song, but I'll sing it again, of the place that I lived on the West Texas plains. In the city of Pampa, the county of Gray, here's what all of the people there say. Well, it's so long, it's been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. This dusty old dust is a-blowing me home. I've got to be drifting along.
The first song that he ever wrote that was played all over the country was So Long It's Been Good to Know You, and this is the Dust Bowl ballad about the, how bad the Dust Bowl was. The dust was blowing so bad that the preacher had called them all in to repent of their sins. You know, the world is coming to an end and all that, and they said the dust was so black that the preacher couldn't read his texts. And so he folded his specs and took up a collection and said, "Go, so long it's good to know you," you know. Characters like that, that make up lines like that, you get a chuckle out of it.
The church houses were jammed and packed. People was sitting from front to the back. It was so dusty, the preacher couldn't read his text. So he folded his specs and he took up collections. Said, "So long, it's been good to know you. So long, been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. This dusty old dust isn't rolling me home. Gotta be drifting along."
In 1936, without compunction, Guthrie left his young wife and family and embarked on 25 years of rambling. He joined the migrants fleeing the Dust Bowl and traveled west to California. He was never to settle again.
The Carter family at that time were broadcasting from Del Rio, Mexico. Now, the Carter family had developed a new guitar style, which was based on the banjo and had action, rhythmic action in both hands, hammering on, pulling off, sliding, mixed with contrastive runs from the thumb, and then playing the melody at the same time. It sounds simple, but it takes a long time to learn. And Woody had been working on the Carter Family lick for years and years. And he put that together with the harmonica style that he learned from this black man, and with a kind of a frailing technique with his right hand, so that his guitar buzzes and rumbles and bounces and jumps and skitters and sings all at the same time. It's a unique sound that Woody has. If you'll go back, if you'll listen to it, it's really like, I don't know, it's like being in a big truck and hearing a song sung at the same time, because Woody was riding those trucks, and the sound of trucks, and he was riding the train. So you hear the pulse of the drive wheel and the whistle of the locomotive and all that, the racket of the wheels, the regular racket of the wheels. It's all going on with that guitar style of Woody's.
California. I made about three trips back to Texas and back to Oklahoma and back to California again by freight train. And every time I saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands of families of people living around under railroad bridges.
I'm stranded on that road that goes from sea to sea. 100,000 others are stranded, same as me. 800,000, yes, 800,000 more, and I ain't got no home in this world anymore.
How did they welcome you with bands and banners and everything, or how was it?
No, they didn't greet us with bands or nothing. They ask us questions when we come across the line. They tried to turn a lot of us back, the hobos that didn't have any money in their pockets, we knew. We remembered the old tractor sitting back down there covered up with dust, the cows standing up on top of the barn and looking out across that dead sea of dust. And we said, no, mister.
Now listen, your friends, I won't tell you about a brand new dance that you gotta learn to do. It's called the okey-pokey. You do it okey style. Now the mean old okey-pokey is bound to drive you wild. When you get started, it's hard to stop. If you don't look out, you're gonna blow your top. When you do the okey-pokey and do it okey style.
Guthrie joined his cousin Jack on a radio station in Los Angeles.
Thank you a lot, Jack. Sure glad you dropped around, fella.
The nostalgic sounds of Oklahoma were popular among the newly arrived migrants. But by this time, Guthrie had developed a style of his own, turning one man's experience into the story of all the Dust Bowl refugees.
Back in 1927, I had a little farm and I called it heaven. Price was up and rain come down and I hauled my crops all into town. I got the money, bought clothes and groceries, fed the kids, took it easy. The rain it quit and the wind got high and the black old dust storms filled the sky. And I swapped my farm for a Ford machine and I filled it full of this gas I lean and started. Drifting to California. Way up yonder on a mountain road, I had a hot motor and a heavy load. I was going pretty fast, I wasn't even stopping. I was bouncing up and down like popcorn a popping, had a breakdown. Sort of a nervous bust down of the mechanism there, some kind of engine trouble. His way up yonder on the mountain road, I wasn't feeling so very good, and I give this rolling Ford a shove, and I was gonna coast as far as I could. Commenced rolling, picking up speed, and there was a hairpin turn, and I couldn't make it. Man alive, I'm telling you, the fiddles and the guitars really flew. That Ford took off like a flying squirrel, and it flew halfway around the world. Scattered wives and childrens all over the side of that mountain. We got to old Los Angeles broke, so that gum hungry we thought we'd choke, and I bummed up a spud or two, and my wife cooked up a tater stew. Fed the kids a big bait of it, but that was mighty thin stew. So that gum thin, you could pretty near read a magazine through it. If it had been just a little bit thinner, I've always believed that stew had been just a little bit thinner, some of our senators could have seen through it.
The migrants that Guthrie traveled with had not wanted to leave their homes. They'd left because their land had literally turned to dust.
They were the first Americans to spectacularly suffer a major disaster in public vision, and gradually the country began to acquire its conscience by regarding the fate of the Okies and the Arkies. Steinbeck, of course, did a great job, and other writers, but I think Woody did a job that was just as important as theirs and has lasted really longer.
Well, the native California sons and daughters, I'll admit, had a lot to be proud of. They had built up in California quite a wonderful empire. Then they hadn't built up quite a wonderful enough empire. What they needed in California was more and more people to pick their fruit, to gather in their peaches, to pick their extra select and their select apricots. But at the same time, they look down, for some reason or other, on the people that come in there from other states to do that kind of work.
He was their spokesman. He was to tell their story. And he believed every word he was saying. He was as devoted to that as any minister that feels he has a call to be a minister. He considered himself a spokesman for the downtrodden and the people that don't have a voice. And I think the reason he could do that because Woody had suffered in his life.
It's a mighty hard road that my poor hand has hold. My poor feet has traveled a hot, dusty road. Out of your dust bowl and westward we rolled, and your mountains are hot, your deserts are cold. California and Arizona, I make all your crops. Well, it's north up to Oregon to gather your hops. Dig the beets from your ground, cut the grape from your vine, to set on your table your light sparkling wine. Green pastures of plenty from dry desert ground, from the Grand Coulee Dam where the waters run down.
ever stayed in this union, us migrants has been. We'll work in your fight and we'll fight till we win.
Back in the 30s, you used to have the coal trains, y'all. All right, you're guaranteed. You're guaranteed they're going to stop. If from one town, they're going to stop from next town. But with these damn diesel engines, you know, they go 300 or 400 miles before they stop.
When are you going to stop?
Huh?
When are you going to stop?
Probably when they bury me. No, I ain't going to stop. I'm going to keep moving until I drop dead.
Well, it's always we've rambled that river and I. All along your green valley I will work till I die. My land I'll defend with my life if it be, because my pastures of plenty must always be free.
Guthrie's original title for This Land Is Your Land was God Blessed America. It was an answer to the Irving Berlin anthem, which he hated, and it expressed his own fierce brand of patriotism.
I'm out of gear.
It became his most famous song, and ironically, a second national anthem, though not with all the original verses.
He's sharp. In the squares of the city, by the shadow of the steeple, by the relief office, I saw my people. As they stood there hungry, I stood there whistling. Why did he whistle? This land was made for you and me. Was a great high wall there, tried to stop me. Was a great big sign there, said private property. But on the other side, it didn't say nothing. That side was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land. You know, what gives me courage is to think that this song was never on the top 40. It was never on the top of the hit parade. But hundreds of millions of people know the song now.
About 30 years old from the looks of him, but he's seen more in those 30 years than most men see before they're 70. Look at the faces of hungry men and women. They've been hobo jungles. He's performed on picket lines. He's sung his way through every bar and saloon between Oklahoma and California. And listen to that red ball roll.
I met him at a benefit, and Woody had just hit town from California, and someone invited him to sing, and he stopped the show. This little dusty-headed man, sometimes he couldn't finish his concerts in those days because he would start talking like Will Rogers, whom he adored, and would keep on telling jokes for maybe an hour and a half and maybe sing one song at the end. Well, that sophisticated New York audience had never heard anything like him, nor had I.
In New York, Guthrie was adopted by a group of left-wing intellectuals who believed that folk music was the true voice of the people. In Guthrie, they found not only a man of the people, but one whose views were even more left-wing than their own. He became the champion of a new musical movement.
Here we were, all trying to look like country, you know, wearing our blue jeans and our work shirts and all trying desperately to look like people from the country, so we had the right to sing these songs, you know. And here comes this guy from Oklahoma, the real thing, you know. When I look back on it now, I wonder what Woody saw when he saw us all.
Nobody I knew literally slept in their clothes all the time. You really were afraid to, nobody would pat, in their right mind, would pat him on the head, because he had, there's so much about Woody was proto. He had proto-Afro hairdos. He had very wiry hair, and it went out like this, and you didn't dare touch it because you didn't know what would fly out. Rats, mice, bats, birds, dead birds. And he was generally filthy.
John Henry, when he was a baby, sitting down on his mammy's knee, picked up a hammer in his little right hand. That's gonna be the death of me. That will be the death of me. That will be the death of me. Lord, Lord, that will be the death of me. Well, the captain, he said to John Henry, I'm gonna break my steam drill around. I'm gonna bring my steam drill out on this job. Hop that steel on down. And I'm gonna hop that steel on down.
Feeling of a sense of history when you were around him. Of course, we were both active communists, and communists have a strong sense of history, too. He and I sang for the CIO unions, many of which were had communist organizers back in the early 40s. When he met up with the Communist Party, he said, hey, here's some guys doing something about it. Now, I knew Jesus was talking about it, but these guys are doing something about it.
And now, friends, this meeting is called in the office of the American Workers' Party, an organization dedicated to the organizing of the working class of America and the overthrow of capitalism. An organization that today...
Jesus Christ was a man that traveled through the land, hard-working man and brave. He said to the rich, give your goods to the poor. So they laid Jesus Christ in his grave. This song was written in New York City of rich man, preachers, and slaves. If Jesus was to preach like he preached in Galilee, they would lay Jesus Christ in his grave.
Have we received a better place to live?
The point is, he believed the image. I guess he believed his image as much as Jesus believed his. You could never have convinced Jesus that he was just another crackpot Jewish radical during the Roman Empire.
Guthrie's sense of his own destiny was confirmed when he was invited to Oregon to write a cycle of songs in praise of the Grand Coulee Dam. This was to be the most productive month of his life. In almost as many days, he wrote 26 songs, all hymns to the American working man.
I've been having some hard traveling, I thought you knowed. I've been having some hard traveling way down the road. I've been having some hard traveling, hard rambling, hard gambling. I've been having some hard traveling, Lord.
He was a little shrimp of a guy, but he really thought highly of the man's way of doing things.
I've been working at Pittsburgh Steel, I thought you knowed. I've been pouring red hot slag way down the road. I've been blasting, I've been firing, and I've been pouring red hot iron, and I've been having some hard traveling, Lord.
Did you like Woody?
No.
Why not?
I found it difficult to like him. I found I was afraid of him. I was very young when I met him. 16, 18, 19, that time. And then a little bit later. I didn't understand him. I knew I was supposed to think he was marvelous. I thought his songs were, they were amazing. But the man was frightening to me. And I was always very uncomfortable with him.
What the hell are you singing a whorehouse ballad for? You're nothing but a virgin. You're a small town virgin. How can you sing a song like that? How can you dare sing blues? As a matter of fact, Pete himself didn't sing blues for years because of that kind of onus that Woody put onto him. So-and-so was college bred, therefore they didn't know the people, capital the, capital P, people. Which may be true, but don't rub it in.
Oh, he'd occasionally needle me about my Eastern mannerisms. Yeah, I think once I did get so mad at him, I stormed out of the house. Maybe I admired him so much that I didn't care if he did insult me from time to time.
The person was revolting to me. I don't know that anybody admired the person. He was offensive, he was insulting. The artist was incredible. So I think everybody put up with the shit of the personality for the diamonds that came out of that mind and mouth. I've tried to describe what Woody's voice did to me, just his voice, and it was, a knife is no good as an image. A razor is better, but a razor is too broad and has too much surface, a stiletto that's sharp all the way, went right in, pierced you through and through, and your hair stood on end. It was a scream or a sneer of extraordinary power.
It's a mighty hard road that my poor hands have hold. My poor feet have traveled that hot, dusty road. Out of your dust bowl and westward we rode. And your deserts was hot and your mountains was cold. California, Arizona, I make all your crops. Then it's up to Oregon to gather your hops. On the edge of your city, you'll see us, and then we come with the dust and we're gone with the wind. I'll work till I die. My land I'll defend with my life if it be. 'Cause my pastures of plenty must always be free.
Dig the beet from the ground and the grape from the vine. to set on your table your light sparkling wine. I mean, that's genius. There's the sweep of America. Two classes in a short verse. And that was Woody. He had that kind of mind, that kind of imagination.
Nothing daunts him, that business about the car couldn't make it on the hairpin curve. The car, we just didn't make it. And the next verse is, wives and children falling all over that mountain. And even the humor of making wife plural, because he knew his own sex life was filled with wives in Brooklyn and wives in Oklahoma and wives all over, and he married several of them.
Guthrie's second wife was Marjorie Mazier, a ballet dancer from New York. Married only 2 years with a baby daughter, he was on the move again. He joined the Merchant Navy with fellow folk singer Cisco Houston and a young Italian New Yorker, Jimmy Longhi.
First time I met Woody, I wouldn't be here, sitting here in my beautiful apartment overlooking the East River, if it weren't for Woody, apart from the fact that he literally saved my life when we were torpedoed, we were in the invasion of France, Normandy. Woody was standing near the porthole. Cisco was sitting in his bunk, tying his shoe. I was in my bunk directly above Cisco, with a pillow behind my head, listening to Woody. And Woody's saying to me, "You never seen Jane Dudley dance the harmonica breakdown?" "No, Woody, I never saw Jane Dudley dance the harmonica breakdown." He says, "Well, before you die, you're going to see Jane Dudley dance the harmonica breakdown." Now, as he's saying this, he is floating through the air. And I'm watching him. And he hits the ceiling, the overhead. What happened, we were hit by an enormous mine, an explosion. My brain went berserk. Everything became slow motion. Woody's lips were moving thusly. And as he was saying, "You must see Jane Dudley dance the harmonica breakdown before you die," I'm watching it. Then, bang, I hear the noise. And we all go boom, boom, boom. The whole ship is flying up and down. And I get thrown out of my bunk. My bunk collapses. It skins Cisco. It almost killed Cisco. Steel bunk. I weighed 200 pounds. But I come down anyway. And I get thrown to the steel deck. And that's all I remember. I was unconscious. The ship is taking water. Woody and Cisco, of course, they run out. They, you know, get up on deck, see what the hell is, you know, where I was, blah, blah. Then they realize that I'm not with them. But Woody and Cisco came down below to find me. They pick me up, and they take me out. So I wouldn't be here if it weren't for them. I never saw Woody laugh. I never saw Woody smile, just flicker of a smile. And I never saw Woody cry. Cisco tells me once Woody cried when his child, 5-year-old child, Kathy, was burned to death in his apartment. And Woody was stoical, and there was no reaction from Woody for 3 days. And they were walking on the sands of Coney Island. And suddenly Woody threw himself on the sand, on his back, put his feet up in the air, and screamed for 3-4 minutes. And then got up and never mentioned it again. But on that half-Indian face, not half, quarter-Indian face of his stoicism, and that calm beauty.
Hello, children. This afternoon, we've got in the studio Woody Guthrie, who's a very well-known singer of folk songs over here, though at the moment you're in the Merchant Navy, aren't you, Woody?
That's right. Washing dishes on a Liberty ship.
And during his leave, Woody has come in to make a program for you. So So, shall we have the first one, Woody? What was it going to be?
Take me riding in the car, car, take me riding in the car, car. Take you riding in my car, car, I'll take you riding in my car.
Well, I really didn't know them then, but I mean, the books have indicated a terrible tragedy with the death of the daughter who was left in the house, and Woody went downstairs to get some cigarettes. When he came back, the poor girl was on fire. They took her to the hospital and she died soon after.
Click, clank, open up a door, girls. Click, clank, open up a door, boys. Front door, back door, clink a dick, clack, take you riding in my car. I'm gonna zoom you home again. I'm gonna zoom you home again. Roll home, take you riding in my car. I'm gonna let you blow the horn. I'm gonna let you blow the horn. Well, I'll take you riding in my car.
In the late 20s, when his sister died, a fire in the house, a lamp kind of spilled over, and Woody came in and found her running around with flames. And then after that, I think it was the death of his mother, who died at, I believe, somewhere at an asylum in Oklahoma. Then you have here in New York, right on this street, Woody's first daughter with Marjorie, died in a fire. She was maybe 5 or 6 years old. then you have almost a litany of tragedies. His son from Mary, Bill Guthrie, perhaps he was in his 20s and he died in an automobile accident. His car got stuck on the railroad tracks and the train hit him. And then after that, his daughter Gwen, who was in her late 30s at that point, got Huntington's disease and died from it. He had another daughter by his last marriage, and she was again in her early 20s at that point, and she was killed in an automobile accident in California. And just last week, I received a letter from Mary, that Mary's daughter, Woody's daughter, is dying from the disease. She's in her, I would say, early 40s or mid 40s. And you have this whole litany of tragedy. And then, of course, Woody.
It is a disease that totally destroys the nervous system. You cannot, the nervous system and mental, it can be both, or it can be one or the other. But as far as any doctor's ever told me, they will tell you it is both. Now, some people are worse than others mentally, but it does affect the brain also. It slowly deteriorates the brain. But you get to where you have no control over any of your muscles. You can't walk, you can't talk, you can't eat, you can't swallow. You just about a vegetable. Now this is after you've had it for quite some. It can take you. Well, my other daughter lived 10 years, but she started out very bad at the beginning. In the case of my younger daughter, she started out slowly, and it's been 17 years now that she's had Huntington's, and I know Woody was in the hospital 15 years. And then I absolutely refuse to think about my grandchildren. That by the time they would get old enough, I'm not going to be around, and I feel that I've got to put that on my head. I'm not going to let that get to me. And maybe they'll have something, but I wouldn't bet on.
See, some people see it as some kind of doom and gloom. I don't see it that way. I see it as just another thing that you have to learn and you have to cope with and you have to get over. And the thing you have to get over is the idea that you are, you know, just some kind of piece of meat walking around that, you know, increases in volume, then turns to dust. If that's all you think you are, you're not going to have the opportunities to sort of move ahead philosophically or spiritually. When I had a chance to go through some of his work, I found out a little bit more like what he was struggling with questions like, why me? How come I got sick? Is God going to help me? Is there any help for me? Can man help me? How am I going to get out of this mess? Is there an out? And I think my dad's journey was a spiritual journey. It was a mystical journey, his whole life.
I've been having some hard traveling way down the road. I've been having some hard traveling boat. This song was put together back in the 1930s by a fellow some of you may know. His name was Woody Guthrie. Woody has been in a hospital now for 10 years. Probably won't write another song. But he was one of the greatest ballad makers I guess I'll ever know. Wrote songs about the Dust Bowl, about the crops of California, wrote songs for his children. A lot of people have heard his songs. They're getting more and more well-known every year. But I thought maybe right now you'd be interested to perhaps see him. This is him.
In the dead hours of night, she rose from her blanket, a battle to fight. She rose from her blanket with a gun in each hand, said, come all of you cowboys, fight for your land.
A new generation was now claiming Guthrie as its own. Tom Paxton, Phil Ox, Bob Dylan, Paul Simon, Joan Baez. His canonization had begun, and his very first disciple was Rambling Jack Elliott, seen here with a bearded Guthrie in Washington Square.
I watched him play really well for about 2 years, 51 and 52. I guess it wasn't until about 1954 that he started to kind of lose the guitar pick at the end of it. He did some things on the guitar that I still cannot do, although I could hear how it sounded. Well, one of them was... I couldn't get him to teach it to me, or somehow, you know, he'd let me learn something. I'd say, hey, how you do that? He'd say, just watch it and steal it. He says, I ain't gonna show it to you. Lead Belly, let me steal from him and you can steal from me. I ain't gonna show you nothing.
The last few years, he couldn't really speak at all. Just a blur came out of his mouth. Bob Dylan visited him, but I doubt they really had much of a conversation. He was just one more young fellow with a guitar.
When Woody got sick, and I used to get his letters that he was writing to me after they were so ineligible, I could not read them. I mean, illegible. That's the word I need to... And when I got these letters that you couldn't read his writing, I would just break down and just boo-hoo. I mean, just boo-hoo, just go all to pieces. And then as I got them regularly, I got where I could get through them. But that was the hardest thing for me to accept. And then I went to visit Woody, and then I saw him. And the only way I was really sure that everything was okay mentally, because... He always liked to tell it in the hospital. He says, I'm the one that looks the craziest. And he says, I'm the only one in here with a mind. And so to check that out, he's sitting there, you know, doing like this. And I knew that he would be briefed, that he knew I was coming and to expect me. And I said, so I knew I thought, well, it's easy for him to say, do you know me? And he'd say, yeah, you're Mary Jo. And I'd say, okay, Woody, what do you call me? What is your nickname for me? You gave me. He says, Tinkin. And I knew then everything was okay.
Gather round me, children. Story I will tell about pretty boy Floyd, an outlaw. Oklahoma knew him well. It was in the town of Shawnee. Saturday afternoon, his wife beside him in his wagon. And into town they rode. There a deputy sheriff approached in a manner rather rude, using vulgar words of language. And his wife, she overheard. Pretty boy grabbed a log chain, the deputy grabbed his gun, and in the fight that followed, laid that deputy down. There's a many a starving farmer, the same old story told, how this outlaw paid the mortgage and saved our little home. Others tell you of a stranger come to beg a meal, and underneath his napkin left $1,000 bill.
Through all we went through, to be cut down by Huntington's courier at the age of 40. It was dignity. I can't believe it. See, Huntington's courier, the mind is clear. It's just that the nerves and the muscles don't function. Now, to see Woody light a cigarette, he wouldn't let anybody else do it for him. And try to strike the match. You don't say, would he let me do it? You just sit there. And finally, he'd get it. And he'd look at you, and through his eyes, he's talking to you, but he can't speak. And the last time I saw him, I said, do you love me? He blinked. That was his way of saying yes.
You have to have a Woody. You have to take them warts and all, like they say. No, I try to remember I knew Woody at the very best time in his life, when he was a young man with lots of ideals and, I thought, a lot of talent. And that's the Woody I center on. That's the one I come in on. And I'm not going to remember any other Woody.
¶¶
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from the California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway, saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me. When the sun comes shining, then I was strolling, and the wheat fields waving, and the dust clouds rolling. The voice was chanting as the fog was lifting. This land was made for you and me.